I'm Ashley Polsky, a fourth-year medical student from the Keck School of Medicine. In this lesson, we'll be discussing the diagnosis, genetics, treatment, and prognosis of retinoblastoma. Retinoblastoma is a childhood intraocular cancer that forms from cells in the developing retina. It's the most common intraocular malignancy in pediatric patients worldwide. Therefore, it's important for both ophthalmologists and primary care physicians to be familiar with the classic presenting signs and features of this disease. Retinoblastoma is a malignancy of early childhood, with about 90% of cases diagnosed before the age of 3. Worldwide, up to 1 in 14,000 children are diagnosed with retinoblastoma. The vast majority of these cases reside in developing countries with high birth rates. In the United States alone, nearly 250 to 300 children are newly diagnosed with retinoblastoma annually, accounting for about 3% of all childhood cancers in the country. The majority of retinoblastoma cases are unilateral, meaning only one eye is affected. The most common presenting sign of retinoblastoma is leucochoria, an abnormal white pupillary reflex that occurs when incident light reflects off of a retinal lesion. This is often observed by family members when taking flash photos of the child. Patients may also present with strabismus, or misalignment of the eyes, which occurs when central vision of one eye is lost due to macular involvement of the tumor. In developing countries in which diagnosis is delayed due to limited access to healthcare, features of extraocular disease such as proptosis may predominate at presentation, although this is rare in the United States. Unlike most cancers, retinoblastoma cannot be directly biopsied because doing so would increase the likelihood of malignant cells escaping the globe and seeding the orbit. Therefore, the diagnosis of retinoblastoma is based largely on clinical examination findings. On examination under anesthesia, the classic fundoscopic appearance of a retinoblastoma lesion includes a pale-colored retinal mass that may have varying degrees of tumor calcification, retinal detachment, or tumor seeding. Various imaging modalities such as MRI, ultrasound, and optical coherence tomography may also be employed to aid in diagnosis. Once the diagnosis of retinoblastoma is established, genetics testing is an important aspect of the retinoblastoma patient workup. Retinoblastoma is almost always associated with mutations in the RB1 gene, which normally functions as a tumor suppressor by interacting with transcription factors to block the cell cycle. Retinoblastoma follows the two-hit mechanism of tumor development, in which two mutations or hits to the RB1 gene are required for tumor formation to occur. When both alleles of the RB1 tumor suppressor are inactivated, uncontrolled cell proliferation can result, leading to the initiation of retinoblastoma. The progression or growth of retinoblastoma is associated with subsequent genomic alterations in addition to RB1 inactivation. These additional alterations commonly consist of gains or losses of chromosomal regions. If the first RB1 hit or mutation is present in the germline of a patient, that patient is considered to have hereditary retinoblastoma, meaning that the RB1 mutation is present throughout most or all cells in the body. Patients with hereditary retinoblastoma have a lifetime cancer predisposition, and about 80% develop retinoblastoma tumors in both eyes. Patients with a germline RB1 mutation also have an increased risk of developing non-ocular cancers such as osteosarcoma, and they're capable of passing the mutation on to their offspring. In contrast to hereditary retinoblastoma, non-hereditary retinoblastoma is unilateral, meaning that it affects only one eye, and it poses no increased risk of systemic malignancy or transmission to offspring. Genetic testing for a germline RB1 mutation may be performed on patients' blood samples using a variety of different sequencing techniques. Such testing is particularly important in unilateral retinoblastoma patients with no prior family history who may be harboring an unknown germline mutation. Prompt treatment of retinoblastoma is essential for maximizing survival of both the patient and the eye. Historically, nearly all eyes with retinoblastoma were enucleated or surgically removed. Even with the advent of new treatments, enucleation is still widely used to treat eyes with advanced unilateral disease. In recent years, however, there has been an increased emphasis on eye and vision-sparing treatment modalities. A common non-surgical approach to retinoblastoma treatment is chemoreduction with focal consolidative therapy. Chemoreduction, or shrinkage of the tumor using chemotherapy, is typically accomplished by the intravenous administration of a 3-drug regimen over 6 monthly sessions. This systemic treatment is then paired with more focally destructive therapies such as laser photocoagulation, cryotherapy, or plaque brachytherapy. Recently, a more localized mechanism of treatment delivery called intraarterial chemotherapy was developed in order to reduce the systemic side effects of IV chemotherapy. In this method, the chemotherapy is directly injected into the ocular vasculature via microcannulation of the ophthalmic artery. Although intraarterial chemotherapy is a relatively new modality, it's currently being performed in numerous treatment centers worldwide, and it's a promising treatment for eyes with advanced disease. Tumor seeding within the vitreous chamber poses a particular challenge to retinoblastoma treatment, as it often responds poorly to typical chemotherapeutic methods. Classically, needle entry into the eye was strictly contraindicated in the setting of retinoblastoma because it increased the risk of tumors spreading into the orbit. In 2012, however, a safety-enhanced approach to intravitreal treatment was developed, including cryotherapy at the injection site, which allowed chemotherapy to be safely injected directly into the vitreous. This technique has been proven safe and demonstrates excellent success in treating eyes with vitreous seeding. Historically, survival from retinoblastoma was poor, and essentially all cases of retinoblastoma with extraocular extension resulted in death. Although survival rates for intraocular retinoblastoma have ascended to nearly 100% in developed countries, this success is largely dependent on timely diagnosis and therapy. Overall survival is decreased in patients with hereditary retinoblastoma, as these patients are more likely to develop additional non-ocular cancers associated with their germline RB1 mutation. Additionally, while extraocular or metastatic retinoblastoma is very rare in countries such as the United States, the presence of metastatic or extraocular disease significantly increases the mortality rate of patients. The majority of patients, however, do not have metastatic disease and therefore have very low risks of death. In these cases, the main prognostic concern is the probability of saving the eye. Various classification schemes have been developed to predict the likelihood of ocular salvage, including the International Intraocular Retinoblastoma Classification Scheme and the TNM staging scheme created by the American Joint Committee on Cancer. For the treating physician, however, accurately predicting the likelihood of saving an eye with advanced disease is difficult. For advanced group D and E eyes, for example, ocular salvage is achieved only in 50% or less eyes, and it's difficult to know which of these eyes will respond well to eye salvaging therapies and which will not. A recent study of tumor DNA within the aqueous humor suggested that genomic biomarkers within the aqueous may someday enhance our ability to predict ocular salvage in eyes with retinoblastoma. Although additional studies are required before aqueous evaluation can play a clear role in retinoblastoma management, the possibility of more targeted prognostication in the future is promising. This concludes the retinoblastoma lesson. Thanks for listening.